I try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. The many trials that seem to never end. His word declares this truth, that we will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope in the promise that he brings, that there will be a place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day.
Good morning, church. Welcome to St. Luke. Thank you for deciding to join us this morning, and I hope you feel welcome. I hope you meet somebody new, and if you can, you can go ahead and make your way to your seat so that we can get started with worship this morning. You can go ahead and stand on your feet. We have joy in the salvation of Jesus this morning, and so we're going to praise his name. We have joy in this house of worship.
God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. He won't be quiet. Our God is shining in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Hung up on that cross, and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, and now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars.
We won't be quiet, and we'll shout out your praise. find my future. And on the day that you arose, the darkness ran for cover. For the King of Kings has claimed his throne. Oh, now until forever.
Good morning, good morning. Welcome to worship. We're so glad that you're here this morning. We thank you for making a worship a priority in your lives today. Just want to remind you to, if you're a guest with us this morning, or if you've been with us for a while and you feel God tugging on your heart and challenging you to take on something new or broaden your depths in how you serve in ministry, want to remind you to fill out the Connect card. You'll see a card in several of the seats in front of you. It may not be in every one, but at least every other one. You'll find a Connect card. We encourage you to fill that out and drop it in the offering plate a little bit later. Want to just mention a couple of announcements. One, and I know that many of you have, and we commissioned them last Sunday, but we have a mission team that left for Mexico this morning. So they're already en route, and so we want to keep them in our prayers that God will not only use them in a mighty way, but that God will use the people of Mexico to minister and speak to them in a mighty way as well. And if you've served in missions overseas, you know that it is very much a two-way street, and they usually get more than you ever feel like you give. So we just pray for God's very best for that trip. Also want to remind you that if you have become a member of St. Luke since the beginning of the year in 2023, we want to invite you to the historical room just across the hallway for a coffee meet and greet time with that and myself and other members of the staff. We just want a chance to connect and touch base and make sure If there's any way that you feel the need to connect and haven't yet, that we provide that opportunity and help you make that connection, because we know that every time when you join this church, you make a pledge to uphold it with your prayers, your presence, gifts, service, and witness. And we want to be a serving church, and we want everybody who is a part of this church to find an avenue to serve. So we encourage that in all of us, and especially for those who have recently joined us. If you have your bulletins in front of you, just make note of the things that are going on this week. And my last verbal announcement will be just a reminder that next week we will have one unified service in here at 10:30. So our God and Country service for the 4th of July weekend will be just one service, everyone together in here at 10:30 next Sunday. So I just wanted to remind you all of that. So with that being said, I will let you all continue in worship. Pardon? Oh, yeah, that's true. I should do that. I should have Miss Nicole come forward and share. See, you go on vacation and you just get out of the rhythm, you know? It's just one of those things.
Come on.
All right. Thank you, Miss Nicole. Appreciate you.
Good morning, everybody. Come on up. Good morning. I love seeing Bibles. I love it. Good morning, good morning. Who's been on vacation? Ooh, where did you go, Sam?
Canada.
Where'd you go, Sills? The beach. Where'd you go? Hawaii? The beach. Where did y'all go? Julian, did you go somewhere? Grayson, did y'all go? You went to Florida. Did you go to the beach? Yes. What is it, Emmett? You did. You did do that. That was spring break. Emmett went to London and Paris for spring break. I bet that was an amazing trip, wasn't it? Well, the Bible actually gives us a little snippet, not about vacations, but about rest time. So today we're going to be talking about upstairs in our kids' room about how Jesus fed the 5,000. And all month long we've been talking about his miracles. But right before Jesus fed the 5,000, do you know what he and the disciples did? They took a break. They rested. In the Bible, in the book of Mark, it tells us that they were weary and they were tired. And Jesus said, come with me to a quiet place and we will rest. And so they removed themselves from all these thousands of people that they had been ministering to and were quiet, and they took a break, right? And so vacation can be that kind of break if it's a restful vacation, right? So there's two things, give me a two, that I want you to know about that you can do when you go on vacation. One is to actually rest, because sometimes our vacations are really busy. So remember to rest when you're on vacation. And number two is take Jesus with you. Now, how do you take Jesus with you on vacation?
Bring your Bible.
That's a good one. Bring your Bible. And can we still talk to God on vacation? Yes, you can pray every day while you're on vacation and bring your Bible and still read your Bible. That's great, Sills. All right, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for rest and time to take vacation with families, God. And we thank you most of all for your son, Jesus. In his precious name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to go on upstairs. And parents, we will come right back down during the benediction.
All right. Thank you, Nicole. We appreciate it. As we prepare to receive our offering, and I'm going to invite the ushers to get into place. Also, one of the things I've been been thinking about a lot recently is just the Old Testament wisdom of the concept of blessed to be a blessing. That extends as far back as Father Abraham. And so as we enter in this time of worship and giving of our tithes and offerings is an act of worship. Let us be reminded of the fact that we are indeed blessed in so many ways. And that blessing we receive is meant to be a blessing to others as well. And this church has done a wonderful job of doing that in so many different ways. And this mission team we just lifted up is one of those ways. But I just pray God's continued tug at all of our hearts to challenge us in new ways to be a blessing to others. So if you would, bow your heads with me and let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this day, this time to worship you. Lord, for the way that you challenge us each and every day to live our faith each and every day. That, Lord, our faith is not reserved to a particular time or a particular location, although we do gather to celebrate and worship together, Lord. But the mission field, your mission field, is really when we walk out the doors and how we live and serve and minister the other 6 days of the week. So, Lord, by your Spirit, guide and strengthen us to be all that we were meant to be in and through you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
are set apart. There's nowhere else for us to look but to you. So, Father, we come to you this morning with full hearts. And we praise your name. We give you our worship. And we lay down our lives. We say we love you. We serve you. We want to be more like you. So all hail, King Jesus. We place you on the throne. And we set you above every other name. Thank you, Father, for being a good king. Love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. It is so good to be back with you this morning. I think I'm having one of those Sundays that we pastors have from time to time. Where you just you're kind of caught in the moment of just being aware of just what a high and holy privilege it is to do what we do. And so I'm just very grateful to be up here this morning, and I'm very, very aware this morning of how unworthy I am and how grateful I am to God for allowing me to do this. Tragedy has a way of both shaking us and shaping us. The year was 2015. Some of you may remember this. Some of you may not. It happened here in Georgia. It was a foggy Wednesday morning on April 22nd, 2015. And it was slightly before 6 a.m. when there was a bad car accident near Savannah. And five young ladies who were set to graduate with nursing degrees were killed in this terrible accident. And it was a tragedy that weighed heavy on the hearts of many people, myself included. Even though I didn't know any of them personally, there were a couple in my church in Washington County in Tennell, Georgia, who at the time they had a connection with one of the young ladies who died. And even though I didn't know them personally, I respected them greatly, because having a wife who is in the healthcare profession, I respect greatly those people who choose to deal in blood and vomit and bodily waste on behalf of people they don't even know, choosing to do something that most of us would barely even consider doing for those we know and love the most, even under extreme circumstances. And I remember it was an early Easter that year. We had just celebrated Easter 2.5 weeks before, April 5th. And so April 26th, 4 days afterwards, I was going to be in the pulpit. And I remember after hearing that accident, I scrapped what I was going to preach. And I wrote a new sermon based on the text I'm going to preach from in just a moment. But as I was preparing to get in the pulpit that April 26, 2015. That was also the same morning. The news flashed across my phone that horrible earthquake in Nepal that had killed 2,000 people. So it was one of those memorable Sundays, April 26, 2015. So tragedy upon tragedy, and only God knew at the time where I would be a little over a year later. As I stood in the pulpit at Blackshear First Methodist Church in Sunday number four, not even quite week four, but Sunday number four of my new appointment, having to stand before the congregation, and most of them didn't know at the time, a few of them had heard, but to stand before this brand new congregation that barely knew me and I barely knew them, and let them know that our incredibly gifted and talented 28-year-old pianist had been murdered by his roommate who had fled the country to Mexico. Tragedy shakes us and it shapes us. And Sundays like that remind me of the brevity of life. And much like this morning, I began asking a question that almost sounds like an old proverb. And that question is this: when is nothing everything? When is nothing everything? Probably pretty much everyone in this room has experienced tragedy at some point in their lives. It comes quick, it comes like a hurricane, and it suddenly leaves behind a path of emotional devastation. Those tragic moments, those difficult times, I often refer to as Good Friday moments. When the world has seemingly been at and done its worst, and we are left to try to pick up the pieces of shattered lives, be it our own or others. And it's a task that sometimes leaves us feeling very overwhelmed. That feeling of darkness and hopelessness, where it feels like things just will never be quite right again. And for some people, it's a relatively short period of time. For others, it's a stay that is much longer than they would have wanted, and the end cannot come soon enough. So when is nothing everything? I want to invite you to grab your Bibles and turn to Romans chapter 8. And we're going to start by reading verse 31, and we'll read on to verse 39. But as you're getting that in your Bibles, I want to say this. Romans chapter 8 has been considered by many to be the most complete theological chapter in all of Scripture. What Paul does in Romans 8 is pack a lot of theological punch when it comes to life in this one chapter. I've preached a whole sermon series just on Romans chapter 8. But today, I want us to read the last verses of that chapter. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, he will not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, persecution or famine, or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, and here Paul is quoting one from the Psalms, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. And Paul responds, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If you would, pray with me just a moment. Lord, may your word speak in clear truth to our hearts this morning. May these be your words. In Christ's name, amen. In these verses that we just read, Paul names things that are often a source of trouble or division in life as we know it. Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, the sword. We read these things, we hear these things, we're not surprised by this list. This has been a part of the human condition for as long as humans have been around. But then Paul goes on to give us another list, which isn't quite as obvious, but a little bit more mysterious. Paul speaks of death and life and angels, rulers, things present, things to come, powers, height, depth. Many of these things are in work in our lives. Sometimes they result in good, sometimes not. And in addition, as I noted as I was reading it, Paul throws in a psalm for good measure, for extra emphasis. And he spells it out a little more graphically. For your sake, we are being killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. So Paul, in essence, includes the suffering of both life, just part of what it means to be human, but he also throws in what it means to endure the suffering of those who choose to follow God, to be to recognize that we are called by God and one of God's own. Neither one of these things are elevated above the other, as if one were more desirable or another less difficult. And while both may threaten to separate us from the love of God, Paul reminds us that neither one can. So again, I ask the question, when is nothing everything? When we remember these verses, that nothing can separate us from the love of God. I remember in the VBS of 2015, we talked about this verse, as it turned out. And I remember we were kind of trying to get the kids amped up a little bit, and we had a little bit of a chant going, and I'd call out one of the things from the list, and I would say, "Can hardship separate us from the love of God?" And the kids would respond, "No, nothing, absolutely nothing." And I'd call another thing, and they'd respond, "No, nothing, absolutely nothing." And to hear those kids say it with such emphasis is something that just sticks with me. In addition to nothing being able to separate us from the love of God, as we remember the passion of the Christ, as we remember Jesus' last days on earth, we are reminded there is nothing, there is no lengths to which God would not go on our behalf. And then we remember Easter Sunday, nothing is what was found in the tomb when the women went to dress the body. And what's more, nothing could keep our Savior down. Because of God's faithfulness in raising Jesus from the dead, both the present experience of suffering and the future experience of suffering have been transformed. So when the storms come, we can be reminded that we serve the master of the storm, whether it be the storm that rages around us or whether it's the storm that rages inside of us. The same God is master of both. And the same God reminds us that he will never leave us nor forsake us. We do not walk in those Good Friday moments. We do not walk those Good Friday paths alone. During the Great Depression, there was a man named Joe. He had a logging business, a little sawmill. And he would haul saw logs on his bobtail log truck. And one rainy afternoon, he was traveling a particularly unfriendly stretch of road. It was the kind of road that was not the easiest, even under the best of conditions, much less the sloppy ones of that day. And as was turned out to be no big surprise, the truck ended up slipping off the road and ended up going in the ditch. And Joe had remember passing a farmhouse about a mile back, and so he kind of hoofed it back to the farmhouse. He found the farmer, and he said, would you mind hooking up your tractor to my truck and help pulling it out of the ditch? And the farmer said, well, actually, my tractor's not working right now, but I have a really good mule. His name is Old Blue. And he said, well, I appreciate that, but this is a pretty heavy load. I don't think one mule is going to be able to do it. To which the farmer replied, well, you don't know Blue. And so the man said, all right. Joe was like, okay, well, certainly can't hurt, so we'll give it a try. So they hook up Old Blue to the truck. And the farmer cracks the whip in the air. He says, all right, Blue. And Blue leans forward. Nothing happens. He cracks the whip in the air a second time. Come on, Mac. And Blue leans forward a little bit, and the truck moves a little bit. And the farmer cracks the whip in the air again, says, come on, Maud. And Old Blue leans forward, and that truck slides out of the ditch. And Joe can't believe it. He is dumbfounded. It's like, that was unbelievable. I just got to ask, why did you call the mule by three different names? And the farmer replied, Old Blue is blind. And if he thought for one second he was the only one pulling, your truck would still be in that ditch. Never underestimate the power of believing and knowing, in our case, believing in Blue's case, but knowing in our case, that we're not the only ones pulling. That we have a God who is pulling with us. We have a God who's pulling for us. We don't need to go at it alone because we're not alone. There is help. There's divine help. There's also human help. You and I, as followers of Christ, we are called to be stretcher bearers. What do I mean by stretcher bearers? I mean those who rally around their friends and sometimes people they barely know to help them get to a place where they need to be when they lack the strength to do it on their own. The visual I have for that is I think back to that story where the friends brought their friend on a stretcher to Jesus and they had to, remember, they had to cut out the hole in the roof and lower him down because he lacked the ability to do it on his own. And the fact is that there are times when people fall. And for those who have fallen, they need to be encouraged. And when they find it difficult to move forward, sometimes we got to come alongside them and lift them up and help them move forward because they don't have the strength to do it on their own. And when we're honest with ourselves, we can look back and remember those times in our life when we didn't have the strength to do it on our own. And people were stretcher bearers for us. Because nothing is impossible with God. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. One thing I know is that God can and does redeem even tragedy in a way that can lead to powerful testimony. Some of you this morning may be walking a Good Friday path. You may be in that season in your lives where it feels like Good Friday. And if you're not, praise God. We celebrate that. But maybe if you're not, maybe you know someone who is. I'm here to remind all of us, myself included, that sometimes, even when it seems like there's no end in sight, Good Friday does give way to Easter. And light does break through the darkness. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ assures us that the worst thing is not the last thing. There is hope for the hopeless. There is rest for the weary. Sometimes we need to cry out to Jesus. But we do so with the confidence that he hears us. To remember that there the day will come where light will pierce through the darkness and Easter will be here. You heard me say it before, and I'll say it again. We are an Easter people. It doesn't stop with that one Sunday in April. We are an Easter people. We are loved with the everlasting love of an everlasting God. And I am not merely convinced, I am convicted that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And that nothing means everything. That nothing makes all the difference. So for those of you this morning who are standing in the middle of your Good Friday journey, we will continue to lift you up. Both in prayer and any other way that we can come alongside and lift you up. I can't tell you how long it's going to be. It may be a while. We know that it's different for different people. I don't have a one-size-fits-all timetable. But I do know this, that in the end, there is victory in and through Jesus, and because of him, nothing ever can and nothing ever will separate us from the love of God. And I pray this morning that you let that truth, you let that unshakable, infallible truth penetrate the deepest part of your heart. Nothing could ever separate you or me from the love of God. And that Easter can, will, and does come again. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. As the band comes to lead us in our closing song, as we do each Sunday, we want to invite you as we close in worship, whether it's through song or whether it's through prayer, to just have that time where you just give it all to God. It's the best way to start our week. We know that. It's to put everything before our Savior and just let Him have it all. Let Him guide us, direct us, convict us, challenge us, whatever needs to happen. But God is the one who makes it all work for those who love Him. So let Him take whatever it is you have to give and make something beautiful and life-changing out of it. I didn't know that they were going to sing that song this morning until I walked in, and I'm so glad they did. That is one of my, I've seen just a lot of hearts change when that song is sung, and I just pray, even if it only be for one this morning, that that be the case. If you would, please receive the benediction. Gracious God, we do fall down, we do cry, holy, holy. We do recognize the fact that we don't always have the strength to do things on our own, but we do know that you do. Because of the gift of the Son, our resurrected Christ and Savior, that there is nothing that can or ever will separate us from you. Lord, that is not a reality to be thought of lightly. It is not a reason to cheapen grace, but it is a reason to live each and every day into the reality of who you are and who you call us to be each and every day. So Lord, by your Spirit, give us the strength to do exactly that. And I pray your love and grace upon each person, each family gathered here. May you keep them. May you draw them nearer to you and one another. Bless their homes and their families. In Christ's name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Have a great week, everybody. Amen.